Good evening and welcome. I'm your host, Mary Davis, and of course, you're looking at The Mary Davis Show. And my guest, whom you probably all know by now, on my immediate left, is Terry McKelvey, or Terrence D. McKelvey. He's an attorney here in Buffalo with McKelvey, Sims, and Davis. And on his immediate left is Frank Gist, and he writes a column, Is That Right?, that appears in the Buffalo Criterion.
Happy New Year, Terry.
Thank you, and same to all of you. And on my immediate right is Roscoe Henderson. He is co-host of the Community Hour, which airs on radio station WUFO 1080, I believe is the call letters.
Yes.
And on his immediate right is the Honorable Betty Jean Grant, the hardest working legislator in Erie County. Unfortunately, she will not probably come back again as chair of the legislature. She is one of two black women on the legislature, and the other black woman on the legislature, Barbara Miller Williams, has vowed to make sure that she does not vote for another black woman. So unfortunately, those are some of the things that are going to take place in 2014, which we can kind of look forward to, and that is unfortunate that you only have two black women and one makes a statement like that. Tonight on the show,
well, we started out in kind of
2013, the year in review, a year many would like to forget. And as I said before, we're going to talk about some local issues. We're going to talk about a lot of other issues too. So stay with us. We're going to be moving a little bit fast. 2013, the year of the quiet death of unemployment benefits. This is something I feel. 1.3 million Americans are slated to lose their federal unemployment benefits at the end of the year if Congress does not extend unemployment benefits. 20 million Americans are either unemployed or underemployed. Jobs are harder to come by the longer you are unemployed. And then we're going to talk about particularly after you've been out of work after 27 weeks, it's going to be pretty hard to get a job. Republican Senator Rand Paul on the unemployed. That's what he said. I'm just repeating what he said. Unemployment insurance allows unemployed people to stay out of work longer. I can't imagine any unemployed person who longs to be perpetually on unemployed, which only pays usually not even half what your original salary was. So this to me was, I can't even imagine anybody saying that. We need to remind Senator Rand Paul that unemployed workers contribute to the economy because they spend their unemployment checks as soon as they receive them. So that certainly is putting money in the economy. Rich people really don't do that. Now, where are the unemployed? People wonder, well, where are all these people who are unemployed? Where are they? Well, they're in every state in the union, with New York, New Jersey, North Carolina, Rhode Island, Nevada, Louisiana, and Georgia leading the pack. That's where the unemployed are, all over the United States. The Republican-led Congress seems to lurch from crisis to crisis. The federal budget crisis was waged in early 2013 and seems headed for round two in 2014. Poverty and unemployment loomed large in 2013 and will most likely continue in 2014. SNAP, formerly known as food stamps, had its budget shredded in 2013 by the Republican House of Representatives. The ungrateful poor, how dare they whine about not being able to live off $1.47 per meal per day. Now, SNAP affects a lot of your neighbors here in Buffalo and Western New York. How many are not on food stamps? Maybe we'll get a chance to ask Legislator Grant about who is on food stamps and who's going to be affected by this. This is not just people elsewhere. These are your neighbors right here in Erie County. And something else we need to think about. There are many Trayvon Martins. There were many in 2013. Will it change in 2014? Probably not. Is it time to repeal? Many states are coming more and more and more. The Stand Your Ground laws. And then what about the school to prison pipeline, which you're probably seeing here in Buffalo? We have an attorney here who practices a lot of times in Buffalo City Court. We also have Frank Gist, who is oftentimes in City Court himself, and probably see many of these, school to prison pipeline people. And certainly in another life, I would say that Roscoe Henderson probably sees many of these from school to prison pipeline candidates. You know, so we can see that again. Now, as far as criminal justice goes, liberty and justice for all is not, in my opinion, on the horizon. President Obama's very, very limited use of his pardon pen. In fact, granting fewer than any other U.S. president since the founding of the Republic. I don't know how many of you knew that, but maybe this is what we need to think about. And something else that we probably need to talk about that we haven't, that we're going to talk a little bit about tonight. You see, we got a lot of ground to cover, a lot of ground to cover. We hope that we're going to get to all of it. Now, the Republicans' assault on the Affordable Care Act, or is it known, Obamacare, how many people right here, your neighbors, aren't affected by that? Just how many aren't that you may even know or that you're probably sitting next to you are affected by it. Now, voting rights, the middle class, now these are Republican assaults on reproductive rights, which concern a lot of women, immigration, which everybody is talking about, LGBT or gay rights, or anything with President Obama's name attached to it comes under attack. And that's anything. Now, internationally, the continued use of drones is really undeclared war on Middle East and African countries. I think that Frank Gist wrote a column about that recently because I read it, about drone warfare and dropping bombs on other countries. And to me, this is undeclared war. And AIPAC and Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's effort to force the U.S. into a war with Iran. Now, we're still in a 10-year war. You know, how many people around here want to get into another one? And Edward Snowden shined a very bright light on doings at the NSA. And how many people, when they pick up your phone, who's listening to my conversation? And there are trigger words that you can say on a phone. And I use them a lot, so I can imagine somebody's been listening to my conversations.
Well, that's not what they're saying.
I'll have to tell them that Roscoe Henderson was on there, too.
No, but in fact,
and Roscoe, do you mind being quiet a minute here?
Okay,
and who can forget former New York City Congressman Anthony Weiner's body displays on Facebook? Now, Roscoe, you finally make your statement.
Go ahead and defend Anthony Weiner.
We're going to defend Anthony Weiner.
Well, I won't defend Anthony Weiner, but what I would say is that a federal judge out of New York City just said that it is legal, but the thing is if you understand data mining and mega data and the whole concept that's behind it, they're not listening to anyone's particular conversation.
They're listening to certain words.
They're not even doing that. If you read it, it's talking about they look for patterns. And the fact is that if there's an individual who they suspect that might be involved in something, then they go back and say, okay, what are the connections? They're not listening to people's conversations or keywords and whatnot. That's not how it works.
Benny, what do you think on this issue of privacy that he started out with? I have a big problem with that.
Mm-hmm. I got a big problem with it, too. I know that one court ruled one way, and like Roscoe said, the other court ruled that the NSA doing what they're doing is perfectly legal. And on my phone, was a land phone, a cell phone, I'm mindful of what I'm talking about. If there's anything regarding the government, then I'm going to be really thinking about, is this being recorded?
Mm-hmm.
So I think that, freedom to have a phone conversation without the government hearing, I got listening advice. And I think that they can come into your own home and put in bugs if they suspect you of any activities and nothing you can do about it. They can go in your house and you already know they've been there.
But they've
and
been
that's been done
well,
before.
But if that plane goes down like 9/11, you know, then you're going to say, well, did you do enough?
Well, let me ask you this. Would it be perfectly okay for Russia to have the same information on us to tap our lines?
If they could do it, they would. And who says that they are not? They just didn't have.
But would it be?
They just didn't have an Edward Snowden who may have gone to Russia to show them exactly
how it could be done. That's
not my question. That's not my question.
Would it be okay?
Hey, put it this way: it's up to that nation. I can't tell a nation what to do, but I know that if they could do it, they would.
Well, we'll leave it go with that. What do you think, Terry? You haven't weighed in on this.
Well, I mean, as far as the issue of Russia, yeah, we would all object to it, but they're possibly and probably doing it now to whoever they want to because that kind of technology is...
Well, what does anyone think about Mr. Snowden? I kind of like Mr. Snowden. I think that...
He's a traitor.
Well, he's not a traitor. I think that he was...
He's a whistleblower, if you look at
it. It's a big difference.
And that's the case, come back to America and prove your case.
If I was Mr. Snowden, I would stay as far away from these shores as I possibly could. There's no way I'd be coming back here.
It's the culmination of Big Brother in 1984.
Yes.
Big Brother is here. They can listen in anything. The government can find a justification to spy on, which is totally against the reason why the founders made the Fourth Amendment, unreasonable search and seizure.
Right, but that's if they were looking at the information, but and listening to these conversations.
Well, that
but
is
that's
not what, how it was. Why, that, that is what
so
you're
the
saying.
United States, so United States has a legitimate reason to listen.
No, United States. You said
United States has a legitimate reason to listen to the conversations of a legitimate reason to listen to the conversations of a president of Germany. That's a legitimate reason.
I mean, that's legitimate. Is this,
I mean, it's only good for you when it's only good for you when it benefits you. But if it happens the other way, then it's a different story.
If there weren't safeguards in there, so you,
I think all police officers should be monitored to see if they're doing suspicious
officers.
And they had cameras in some of the cars, so that when those things happen, that those cameras can protect the rights of those officers.
It was one good thing. There was a camera in the police station.
It also exposes a lot of the corruption of police officers.
That's right. When they put a plunge up this gentleman's behind, it's a good thing they had it then.
YouTube was full of them.
Yes, right. Well, you know, we've got 1.3 million Americans are slated to lose their federal unemployment benefits at the end of this year. In fact, actually on the 28th of December, I believe.
Today.
That they're slated to lose them.
Yes.
You know? So what does anybody think about that?
I think it's very unfortunate.
I think it's kind of a war on the poor.
Yeah, it is. But one thing I think is really, if you say a light in the tunnel, is that Erie County, I look at the unemployment rate in Erie County, and it's at 6.1%.
Is that the actual unemployment rate, or just what the official encounter? Well, are they counting people who are looking for work, dropped, and
no,
just gave up?
No, they're not counting ones who are dropped out of the system. Mm-hmm. They're not counting those. But I think that it's unfortunate those would be losing their benefits at a time when county and state government are pulling back a lot of the safety net programs for these individuals.
Well, the county's got one thing they can cheer about. Chris Collins is gone, you know, and the federal government has inherited him.
Yeah. You know, so instead of doing it on the county level, he can do deservation on a national level.
Yeah,
so this is one
maybe
thing.
He should stay in the county as opposed to, you know, going to Congress and being just as mean and vindictive as he is.
But this this unemployment situation, it's going to be devastating to a lot of people. They just don't know what they're going to do now that they have no source of income. They've been out here busting their hump day after day trying to get some kind of job. Mm-hmm. And it was really a placating to the right-wing Tea Party extremists that we're not going to allow any government spending where we can stop it. And in this case, it's going to hurt many of them. We've always talked about how these people do not work in their own best interest.
They don't vote in their own best interest.
And it's really going to be, in the end, a transfer of money, because it's only that money that they save on unemployment, on food stamps, is going to have to be put into the prison system. Mm-hmm. Because if people don't eat, they commit crimes.
Absolutely.
You know, if you think people get upset when they don't have drugs, when they get hungry, they really start. Right.
And not only the prison system and the welfare system, but the spin-off effects of the benefits of these people spending that money.
They spend unemployment checks are spent the same time people
well,
get
that money. Because the thing is, those folks are putting money back
into the system
right away. Right. As soon as they get it, they put it back in.
That's
what
right.
It raises is the issue, and what we talked about is income and inequality in this country.
That's right.
And the fact is, now on one hand, the Republicans are against extending the benefits, but later this year, after the 1.3 million are dropped off now, then an additional 1.9 later on this year will be dropped off.
Yeah.
And the fact is those are voters at the polls. Mm-hmm. You know, and
a lot of these people with jobs and headshots were the middle class voters, middle class people who did vote. And so, and I guess in some of these safe Republican districts, maybe in Chris Collins's district, they would probably still vote for him even though they were hungry, because they would say, well, they don't vote their own interest. Will kind of protect me.
Chris Collins' district is necessarily a middle class. There's a lot of farmland out there.
Well, that's what I'm still saying. Yeah, I would say that those in his district, basically, would probably be fine with the fact that they don't get food stamps or that they don't get any money.
Well, there are a lot of rural areas that get food stamps.
That's what I'm saying.
And that's the statistics, and I'm not sure what the county is saying now, that, you know what, it's like been an increase in the suburbs and the exurbs.
That's the former middle class. And these people who had been in middle class, they are, because they've fallen out of the middle class rapidly.
Critical part to the whole thing is that they didn't cut back on the farm subsidy.
Exactly.
Which is part of the food stamp program.
Exactly. That's right.
But they allowed these corporate farmers to continue to get subsidies, but they're going to cut that back on the food stamps.
Because there's no farms in the urban area.
There's
no farms on the east side.
And they still haven't paid the black farmers the $1 billion in which the Department of Agriculture had deprived them of years of access to loans, and they still haven't paid that off.
No. And again, we get back to a point where Roscoe made before and I've made in the past. Many, unfortunately, working class and middle class whites simply don't vote their own interest. What is your interest in going hungry? What is your interest in trying to feed a family off $1.47 a meal?
Because they're so consumed with a prejudicial disdain for the people who they think are the beneficiaries of that, they will vote and deprive themselves and be voting against their own interests because of that disdain, because they think that, in particular, in many instances, it's these poor black people who are walking
bleeding
around
the
benefiting.
I think the issue is more complex than that, because you have a lot of white Democrats who are not getting along with a lot of white Republicans. And the fact is that in years past, folks could argue all day, and at the end of the day, they have a drink together, they play basketball together, they had social interactions. Now, it seems that they become ideologues on both sides of the spectrum, and that the thing is that they're not willing to compromise on anything. What was it this year that this was one of the least effective, least amount of laws passed in Congress ever, mm-hmm. and that's because you got people who are not willing
But the reason is, Russell, what I'm talking about is the root of that is their constituency. Mm-hmm. And they are pleasing their constituency because they believe that that's what their constituency
well,
wants them
to do. I think it's
do.
A combination of things. You also look at, they took the Republicans took out the pork barrel, right? And in the past, the House Speaker, he would be like, well, hey, if you don't support me on this, I'm going to cut you out of that. They've done things that have had other effects in their ability to lead.
Well, that's all related to the internal struggle and war within the Republican Party. I mean, the right-wing extremists have gone off so far that they have nothing but to say but badmouth the Republican leadership, who in any at any time where they try to be anywhere near reasonable. Mm-hmm. So they're going to pay for that, and most of the time they fail to be reasonable because they're concerned about that radical extreme constituency.
And they're going to turn that around because the person, as far as the food stamp goes, people that's being hurt the most is the food industry. You know, you go in any supermarket and see how many people's line up with food stamps.
Yes.
Now, if you to take away that revenue for mm-hmm. from the, especially from like Tops and, you know, that's a lot of revenue that they're mm-hmm. going to be missing. And they're going to be up in arms about that real soon, you know, because mm-hmm. that's really a money transfer because it's from the government right to the grocery stores.
Right. Well, you know, I think why the attacks can be so hard on the poor and why they're starting to mess now with a lot of middle class programs is because the poor don't seem to have any advocates. They don't, like the middle class had advocates, you know, they were out there and they could go there and demand votes and demand different things. They didn't dare mess with them. They're messing with them now. But the poor never had these advocates. There was no one ever to really fight for the poor.
Well, I don't necessarily.
I don't know that.
Say, I can't say that. This is just one of these Tea Party things that this whole we're going to save America by cutting back on everything.
Who's an advocate, Franklin, for the poor?
Well, you at one point in time had a war on poverty, Lyndon Baines Johnson.
Now, yeah, but Lyndon Baines Johnson is not around anymore.
Right.
So, what advocate do they have now? Who's an advocate for the poor now?
I think there's a lot of advocates for the poor.
Even Barack Obama. How many politicians do you hear, and Betty Jean, you can hop in on this one too, as well as Ross, I know he will. How many of these people now, when you listen to public officials, all of them, and they're getting up and they're espousing what they want to do, it's always the middle class. Mm-hmm. You ever hear anybody talk about the poor or the working class or the working poor? Who are you talking about that?
I think it goes even deeper than that because you have an ideology where people are saying, I'm against the government. Elect me because I'm against the government, that they don't want anything accomplished.
I want to shut down government.
Right, and so then, you know,
and then
they go to Congress and do the very thing that they say they're going to do.
But how is this advocating for, who is advocating for the poor? When we hear our public officials talking, the only thing they talk about is, that's from Barack Obama on down. We never hear them talk about poor, working poor, or
well,
just plain old
all your liberal
work,
friends,
unemployed workers.
All your liberal friends, what about them? You're liberal, and yet where are they advocating for the poor?
Well, you listen to one right now.
But you're not a congressman.
And that's the problem, it's the Congressional Black Congress. Usually, in the years past, you come out with a statement there for this, for that. They're quiet. Are they still organized? as a Black Caucus, Roscoe?
They are. They get together in September, and they have their big party and whatnot, and they do all sorts of lobbying. But, you know, in terms of making a difference, mm-hmm. you know, they remember, they ostracized or didn't really work with Obama when he first was elected.
Right.
And that they went with Hillary Clinton when she ran for president. And the only reason they changed is because folks were in their districts were voting overwhelmingly for Obama, but they don't have that relationship with him mm-hmm. so that they can work with him like other politicians.
What does that have to do with anyone saying we need to get some programs for the poor? We need advocates for the
Bernie
poor.
Bernie Sanders, the Senator Bernie Sanders, he's a big advocate for the poor.
He's by himself.
And when you advocate for the poor, you put yourself at risk. They crucified Jesus for virtually doing that. This new pope started advocating for the poor.
Right.
He's being bad-mouthed on Fox News like he's demonic for advocating for the poor. So when you...
Isn't what a refreshing breath of air that's blown through the Catholic Church?
Well, it's not blown through the Catholic Church, it's blown through the Pope. You know, he talks about globalization and saying, hey...
But he is the face of the Catholic Church. I'm glad to see this man doing this.
I would say so, but the thing is...
And he certainly is an advocate for the poor.
But the thing is going with what Terry's saying, is that they are attacking this man for just being humble and trying to help the less fortunate. Mm-hmm. They were upset when he went and kissed the feet of a Muslim or helped a woman and things mm-hmm. of that nature. And it's just that prejudice that, you know what, it comes out.
They don't want a pope who's going to act like Jesus.
Right.
And if he's acting in any way like Jesus, they're through with him.
Can you imagine what would happen if Christ, this swarthy man, not 6 foot tall, with kinky hair, walked into any church today in his sandals and long, like, robe on? He'd be thrown out of the church.
Well, virtually, some of them want to throw this new pope out of the church, you know, mm-hmm. and, you know, to do what he's doing, to present himself in a non-materialistic way, to not want a special limousine, to go out directly and meet with the people, want to drive the same old car. I mean, they're repulsed by that.
I don't know if as many people just rejecting that. I mean, maybe the establishment people, but,
but
I think as being a Catholic, I don't know if anybody
I think it's rejuvenated the Catholic Church. I mean, there are many people who have been on the fringes hanging out there. I no question, Frank, I agree with that. But what I'm talking about is the people that we're referring to who are anti-supporting the poor, quote-unquote.
Well, the thing is, he hasn't made abortion and some of these other issues.
Gay rights.
It's like, well, hey,
don't he said about gay rights, he said, you know, who am I to judge them?
Right. And that pisses them off.
Royally.
Exactly.
Right.
Because again, that's like Jesus. You know, if you can make these analogies all day long, and you'll find out that these people who are the extremists on that side, most of their positions is contradictory to what they supposedly purport, which is the New Testament and the Gospels.
We know we have this problem of unemployment and this problem of poverty. To me, it's kind of like a big giant mouth with a lot of sharp teeth in it, because it's going to rise up, I think, in 2014 and bite a lot of people in the butt. I just don't see how you can go from alert from crisis to crisis. Now, I don't know if the Republicans over this new budget fight will close down the government again. I can't imagine they'd be that stupid to try and do that again, but they might. They just might.
Well, with the budget passed, the opportunity for them.
I mean,
that out of the equation.
No, there's another vote. I think they have to do another debt limit vote this year.
And that's going to be another crisis.
It has not been a good year.
Well, they realized they had to do something because this next 2014 elections is coming up, and they knew that they were on a hard sell to get anybody reelected.
Well, the thing is, they accomplished a little bit, but they just don't want to take off the focus on the fact that Obama's Affordable Care Act rolled out so poorly. Mm-hmm. And you would say that after 3 years, that they should have been better prepared for their computer system. And the thing is, it's given the Tea Party of all folks the ammunition they need to attack them.
Yeah, but I think that's just a media makeup that it was poorly. I mean, yes, something was wrong, but any major initiative like that takes time to get up. Yeah, and I think this whole media, he did it poorly, he did it right. Maybe so, but that's more of a media spin on it.
Let's say you're right, but guess what? When these guys do the polling, and they're like, now more people distrust the president and his poll numbers. Folks that are liberal Since, you know, data guys, and they're saying, look how low his numbers have gotten.
Yeah, but
that he's looking at the 40s.
But
you got to ask how these questions are asked.
Yeah, and not only that, but listen, the Republicans don't have an alternative in terms of the Affordable Care Act. No, they don't have an alternative in terms of a person to compete with Hillary or anybody else.
Yes, right.
They don't. So you're not really. I understand what you're saying about the bad mouthing.
Lady who could but say, I'm not a witch.
You don't think Jeb Bush or Chris Christie, they said that those would be head up. They've done polling
Chris
now.
Chris Christie is a New Jersey bully, and he might be great in New Jersey. I'm not sure how this would play on a national scene.
I mean,
I'm not
polls,
sure I would
and
not on
that, these are the same polls that had Romney ruining the election, you know.
Yeah, and internally. You know,
no, that was.
And just because somebody tells you something don't make it true.
But Romney pollers were off, but there were other folks that, if you look at them, they were right on target.
The media has a way of forming opinion and making you people form an opinion. They'll say, well, the sky is green today. And if you say it enough, people will say, yeah, the sky is green.
And
you know, and I just what I kills me about you sometimes.
I mean, I agree with you on that, but. Okay, back to you, Mary.
Were any of you surprised at all that New York was one of the leading states? This was a particular map that I had to look to showing where the unemployed are. To find that New York was right up there among the 10 states in the country, there was New York.
Well, it was one of the most populated states, so that might stand the reason.
That was right up there with the number of unemployed. Was anybody kind of taken aback by that type of fact?
No, because I know over a period of the last 25, 30 years, we've lost people as well as industry. And when you're struggling with those numbers, and I think we're going to lose being the third most populous state as well. We're going to lose that to Florida, if not this year, then certainly next year. So the people are moving, and the jobs are moving where the people are moving to. So I'm not surprised.
Well, I don't know if jobs are all that plentiful in a lot of these other states.
Well, I mean, an issue that I know some of you feel very strongly about fracking. I mean, hey, when you don't at least consider something that can create a lot of jobs, then people are going to go where the jobs are at, and then those states that fracking is there, they're hiring people by the thousands.
Yes, but what
well, that's not North Carolina, and that's not Florida. You're fracking in Pennsylvania, and I think that if you look at Gas Lands or Promised Land, those two films, you have another idea on fracking.
That's right. Well,
the report is out. The report is out that whether it's safe or not. And how are we going to do something that is going to make a few people rich? Because those people owning those wells are getting from $35,000 to $40,000.
Well, I don't think people should be on unemployment forever. And I think that you should have some type of jobs. And right now, what industry is there that's being created? There isn't
any. But
it's expensive, it rapes the environment.
Absolutely.
And those are temporary jobs. Once they get those pipelines in, those jobs are going to disappear. Like
they'll last me this, so you don't think they should build a pipeline from Canada down to Texas?
No, I don't. I think that it's going over a lot of very delicate lands. Mm-hmm. I think there's a lot of waterways and different other things. Sometimes, Roscoe, there's a more important things than just money.
Well, I'm just saying you're going to have to do something. And I don't know what it is, but then you know what? Just like the Republicans can't come up with an idea for health care, what are the Democrats coming up to deal with getting people jobs?
Well, you know, what the country is actually suffering from, we're still in the virtual recession or depression that we were in from 2006, 2008. What Obama did was he stopped the bleeding, basically, but we're still in a serious economic crunch. And it all starts back with what the Republicans largely did. And again, I mentioned to you guys before that the book by Tom Hartman, where he talks about the fact that there's going to be a serious depression in 2016. Because when you eliminated Glass-Steagall, and you wouldn't separate, build that, keep that wall between gambling banks and the commercial banks, and you let them come up with all these derivatives with nothing but a gambling, you have nothing but a major casino going on with the people on Wall Street making billions and billions of dollars.
What it has contributed to is
that the economy has gotten so bad that what the Democrats and what Obama have been able to do is barely stop the bleeding. And when you have that, of course unemployment is going to be a problem. There's going to be a lot more problems too, where they won't enforce the Sherman antitrust. They stopped doing that. Therefore, you've lost all of the, it was highly detrimental to all the small businesses. So what has happened is that America is now in a situation that it has not been in since before 1928. And we find ourselves in that situation, and you're looking for an Obama, or you're looking for a Romney, or you're looking for somebody short of Jesus Christ to pass a hand and change this. It's going to take dramatic action far above and beyond fracking and permitting fracking and things that are detrimental to our environment.
Yeah, but what are you proposing then? Because as I said,
I'm proposing
now,
one thing. There should be a $15 hike in the unemployment insurance. That's one thing.
Reinstitute Glass-Steagall for one thing.
What about just the minimum wage? I think there should be a federal minimum wage where they raise everybody's salary at least to about $14 or $15.
I agree with that.
Okay, let me go back to fracking. You know, Erie County just passed a fracking law. It doesn't really address the issue of fracking as it does the disposition, transportation, and the storage of the fracking waste. That's most important. That waste is radioactive, and our law simply says that it cannot be stored.
Fracking waste is radioactive.
Yeah, the waste is when you go in those shells and get that gas out, mm-hmm. you go into the earth where radioactivity is, and if you would. Really put a Geiger counter on that fracking material, mm-hmm. the numbers be astronomical. So because you're not going to frack in Buffalo, you're in still Buffalo
Pass. Not to mention what you'll do to our groundwater.
Well,
that's if you go to brush your teeth and turn on the faucet and it catches fire, water.
It requires hundreds of gallons of water, hundreds of millions of gallons of water to break
water.
To actually.
Yeah.
So tell me this, if it could be done
it
correctly,
can cause a lot
would
of
you
health
consider
problems.
It? If they were to address the issues that you've raised, would you get
consider
Well, I think that's what Cuomo has a committee supposedly looking at saying, convince me, show me that this can be done safely. And I think that I don't think they can do it, but right. I think you're right. Yeah, right. You have to be open to that.
Absolutely. Not that, but 15 counties in New York State already have a ban against fracking on county land in the story. So it's not just something that Erie County did or Buffalo did. It's done
nationwide. And another interesting fact that people don't know, did you realize the whole process of fracking was invented by the Koch brothers' father? That's how they made their money? When he invented it, it wasn't economically feasible to do it in the United States, and he became rich in Russia. Mm-hmm. When they started doing it in Russia, and now that it's economically feasible to do it, but the whole process, the pattern belongs to the Koch brothers.
Yeah, okay. I would believe anything coming out of the Koch brothers.
Well, you know, you mentioned Cuomo. Now, I know that you would disagree with me, but I think that the SAFE Act has hurt the Cuomo for this year. I mean, he was like in the 70s. Now he's down at 50. Approval rating.
Well, because he got an election coming up? I didn't know.
Yeah, this next 2014.
Year. I mean, there are rumors that he's going to be, that his lieutenant
governor
is going to step down, and that they're looking for someone in upstate New York
from Buffalo
to fill those shoes. I mean, you see the things that they've been writing in the paper. How, say for example, if Byron were to take it, who becomes the next mayor, the council president, the person who's the council president would be appointed.
We're talking about the Reverend Pridgen, and I'm pretty sure that he's going to be the next council president.
He will be the next council president.
Yes, no, he is. Mm-hmm. He is.
I mean, they're going to vote January 2nd, but he will be.
I mean, the way that he did that, it was like he played a good game of chess. He went to the folks that weren't his supporters, and he said, I want your support, and they were like, fine. Because the person who was council president has gone back and forth on who he has supported, and it was like, you know, what goes around comes around.
Well,
that would be the initial appointment. Will a special election be held?
Yes.
A special election will be held?
Yeah, it'll be held during the primary.
Yeah.
So if he get appointed 2015, then September 2015 will be a special election.
Why is everybody so sure that the call would come to Byron Brown?
I'm not, but I just think that he would have to be someone considered, as well as maybe a Kathy Hochul, because as a white female, you know, she would get a lot of women votes. So I don't think it's in the shoe for Byron, but I think if you can't not count him as a candidate because of what he brings to the table.
Well, just
they also said the lady who's going to run the Republican side, if Astorino gets the appointment, I think she ran for attorney general. You know her name? She has a show.
Oh, I know.
She's a lawyer, has a show on TV, and she's being promoted as being the candidate for the Republican side for lieutenant governor. So Kathy Hochul, you know, name's been put out there, and even Byron's name been put out there in the political circle. So it's not that Roscoe and I are saying Byron Brown.
Right,
that's
right.
The buzz in the community is Byron Brown.
Well, what's the buzz for the Republican candidate?
Astorino. But they worry about Paladini because he said that if Dean Skelos does not resign or he gets terminated, he's going to run runs about a conservative line. He's pushing for.
Well, this is one thing.
He's pushing for Donald Trump to run
right
on a conservative
right
line.
Now, does any of you think that Mr. Paladino has the type of power that they ascribe to him? I think that the news gives him too
he's
much
play. He's got the
play.
Type of money, Mary.
Yeah, but then the newspaper,
he's got
the Buffalo
money.
News, he gets too much play, I think, mm-hmm. for what he might actually, the power he might actually have. I'm not talking about his money. I'm talking about the raw power that he has.
Well, the raw power is his affiliation with the Conservative Party. And Ralph Arrigo has more or less has been saying that Paladino is a big player in the Conservative Party. So he's threatened that if he doesn't get a person, yeah, like Donald Trump to run for president, if somebody like Astorino, who he say he absolutely won't support, then he runs about in a conservative line. In New York State, in order for Republicans to have a chance to win, they have to get that Republican endorsement, that conservative endorsement.
Right, and the thing is if Paladino runs and beats the Republican, I mean, say for instance—
That happened before, right?
Say for instance mm-hmm. Cuomo wins, but Paladino comes in second place, then that means across the state that the Republican line won't be the second choice, it'll be the third choice.
Absolutely.
And that's that's what they're concerned about, mm-hmm. you know? In terms of power, right now, Paladino is in a 5-4 thing on the school board, but the fact is that he would probably be looking at next year's May elections to get control of the school board, mm-hmm. and that's mm-hmm. when he would have power. I mean, he has influence because his money buys him influence.
Absolutely.
Shouldn't this be a problem or something that people on the school board should be looking at? Why does he have that? He owns all of this property which is connected to the school board. Why aren't they eliminating some of that?
Well, there's been incident of conflict of interest has been brought up, and nobody has really followed through on it.
That seemed to be.
I don't know if he owns a lot of property. I think he owns one building. I know for sure.
Oh, quite a few.
No, he's one of the largest property owners.
He is the largest property owner.
Contract with the school board is what
no,
I'm
but,
saying.
No, but the thing about Paladino, my years working on the Common Council, is that, you know, his rhetoric can be bombastic. Mm-hmm. But his skill in terms of doing the actual paperwork and stuff, he is on target, and mm-hmm. that's why he gets what he gets. He is not stupid at all. He's very intelligent.
Yes,
no, he's not stupid. He's just ugly. He just reminds me
I'm not going to say that.
Well, you're not, but I am. He's simply ugly. He's ugly in physical appearance. He's ugly in spirit. He's simply a disagreeable, ugly person in spirit, in attitude, in appearance. An appearance, he reminds me of a hawk.
You're very unbiased, Mary.
Yes, I am. You know, and to me, when you have all of these things going, he is simply a person who seems to be so eat up with bigotry and hatred. I don't care how smart, how much money he got. He is simply a terrible person.
But the thing is this, if you look at the school board, all right, and some of the issues that he's brought up, I mean, there's a building on Lafayette that was like drug dealers, prostitutes. He's gotten that building, cleaned it up, and made it like a model for the kids in the neighborhood. It's a place for them to have a playground and the nights, you know, teachers and working in the community. I mean, I'm not going to take away some of the positive things that he's done.
Well, I'm going to take away, frankly, not on my show. I don't want to hear anything positive about Kyle Paladino.
You're not looking into both sides.
Well, I never said I was. You shouldn't be that biased.
Now, what is this house, though, you did?
No, this is a school. It's a charter school, West Charter School. It's on Lafayette Street, and this is a place that I often would respond to calls where, you know, something was going bad there. He took the building over, gutted it out, and made it into something that's very positive.
Oh, he did. It's in his name. He personally.
And if he turned it into any kind of school, then he had to be either working for solely to the Buffalo.
Most of the building being used for charter schools. The one that's behind the old ECC campus, you know, on Riley Street. That's building, that's the Science Magna Charter School.
Mm-hmm.
Then he has one Central Presbyterian Church on Main and Jewett Parkway. That is a charter school as well. So he has more than one building that's housing school, but most of the buildings are charter schools that are being housed in them.
And what probably a tax deduction for him.
And what they would like to do, of course, is Mr. Paladino has one sole issue, and that is to eliminate public education in the city of Buffalo, perhaps in the state.
His one sole issue is to bring voucher to the Buffalo, the public education. His whole push, the whole push behind charter school
now, is now, when you want to sure. Now, Betty, when you're
that in public education?
When you were on the school
yes.
board,
would, that's what I said.
But isn't that an issue that black parents years ago brought up was the vouchers because they didn't feel that their kids were getting the best out of the public school system? Isn't that an issue?
Well,
that
how black, many no, it was not an issue when I was on the school board. It was not, right voucher was not brought up. Voucher was brought up when I was in the South. When they had those schools to be desegregated, and then whites didn't want their children to attend integrated schools and ask for vouchers. So the only thing I have regarding vouchers been to now was when I was in school in the South in the 1960s.
Oh, so you haven't never dealt with the issue here?
No.
Okay.
No, not at all.
And I'm still saying that, whether it's vouchers or anything else, Carl Paladino's sole issue is to gut and destroy public education. Problem is, where do these kids go when they have closed also, like they've done in Chicago.
But let me say this, with the Say Yes program.
Like you got a school desert in Chicago?
Let me say this, Cal Paladino just got elected this year, all right? Our kids have been failing for the last three decades. He has nothing to do with that, yet we get so sidetracked focusing on this one person when you got a billion-dollar industry in our community, kids failing, where they're only 20% are
Cal
passing.
Paladino,
what does he have to do with that?
I can smell the brimstone from his very presence there.
That is right. So you look at him, and the problem has been there. It's systemic. It's structural. It's in the school system. And the fact is that when we talk about him, we are not addressing the issue.
You can talk about
what was the top stories in 2013?
I mean, the Board of Education. I mean, look at
it. You can talk about that entirely. You can even look at that in higher education. You got higher education basically in New York State, which is really the legislature in New York State is really anti-public education, and particularly higher education. You know, SUNY is under terrific strain mm-hmm. and attack, and that's by the New York State government, mm-hmm. Assembly and Senate.
So are you
so
against
you have
the
this
Common
all the way
core?
Down.
Are you against the Common Core?
In a way, yes. Yeah.
Even though the Common Core is only, is basically local municipalities still keep the curriculum that they want to teach, but it's just the way that they teach it and how kids go about solving the problems.
Well, you know, has any of you ever gone to the website and looked what those questions are, the Common Core exams, what they say and what
not.
They ask?
What are some of them?
I thought they were difficult. I know for a third grader. I had to focus, that's for sure, to answer some of those questions.
But the thing is, the United States has been going last or going in the 30s as developed countries in terms of education. South Korea, China, and these other nations are way ahead of us. And the fact is that they send their best students over to here for our higher education, and then they leave and go back to their countries. Right now, it's not affecting us because we've been so far in the head, but eventually it's going to catch up.
Yeah,
with
but
us.
That doesn't answer the question. How do you educate kids that? It's not
can't
motivated.
Because they're doing it. They're, hold it. They're doing it. So we got to start somewhere.
Now he's saying, how do you educate kids
that's
can't
not
even
motivated
read?
To
you know, the thing is, it starts at an early age. It starts with having
it starts just, at home.
It starts at home.
No, it's deeper than that. It's cultural. It's deeper than that. I'm not going to accept that. Over.
Oh, so it's what? Do nothing?
I'm not saying do nothing.
Then what are you proposing then? I'm not saying
do nothing.
I don't hear nothing from you at that end.
But I'm just saying that the answer to it is not just simple, more money.
Well, I agree with you, Frank, that it's a deep cultural problem. But I also agree with what Roscoe is saying, is that what we don't have is that parental involvement. And the Board of Education's biggest problem is generating that kind of parental involvement.
What about the state involvement? The primary reason I think for the way education is, particularly in poor communities, is public schools are funded by taxpayer money. And that is one of the main problems in poor communities. You don't have these particular problems in more wealthier communities. And I think that when you have a public school system which is based on homeowners' taxes, you're going to get a public school situation that is always going to be underserved and under par.
Well, so how much taxpayer money should we give to
it
education?
Shouldn't be. I think that public education should be supported wholly by the state, not necessarily
local.
Well,
where does the state get the money?
Not necessarily
they get it from
local
property taxes
not
and
necessarily
taxes.
Local homeowners.
Okay.
But I think one thing people have with Common Core, as I understand read it, is that you can't just have an answer. Just say you have 7 minus 4. The answer is 3, right? If a child put 3 on a paper, that's not right because he has not demonstrated how he reached 3. So he had to go through the whole spiel of the 7. He has explained the answer, not just come to the answer. And my whole point is, if you got the right answer, you got the right answer. And if you were
But the thing is I get what you're saying, but see, Common Core is about developing critical thinking skills.
Right.
And the fact is that a lot of times you have a little calculator, mm-hmm. and folks are so easy to just do things there to get removed from things. They're saying, okay, how to think? How do you go about solving, taking in everything
right.
and solving problems? They're not changing the curriculum. It's still the same thing. It hasn't changed any curriculum. When the Commissioner mm. King came here and he spoke at WNED mm. Studios,
right.
you had all the teachers and folks there asking mm. him questions. He explained it, and when he gets a chance to do that, then mm. you say, okay, I get it, but you have people who don't want to change.
Right.
You have unions, BTF, that don't want to change, and that they argue about, nope, we don't want to do this.
I still think we're still not addressing the point that public schools should not be a burden on the backs of local taxpayers. When this happens, this is when you get these fights about what the school buildings look like.
The vast majority of our budget comes from the state.
Do you know what the thing is? The city of Buffalo only gives about $70
right,
million
yeah.
dollars
yeah, yeah.
to the school system. The state mm. puts in hundreds of millions
right,
of dollars
yeah.
into the school system, and we couldn't afford to pay it if we didn't get other folks around the state to help the city of Buffalo.
That's why the state controls everything, because they present essentially
they control like 85 to 89% of the
yeah,
budget.
Yeah,
yeah. Whereas other municipalities, they have property taxes paying a portion of it.
Right.
Whereas
yeah.
Buffalo,
and then they can vote to increase or decrease, and they have more say in terms of if a teacher or principal or a superintendent's not doing their job, they get rid of them.
Then who basically controls in New York State the state assembly, the state senate?
Controls what?
Controls what?
Controls particularly the people that control the representatives in that body, who mainly they are.
Their constituents. And, yeah,
and who has the biggest voice in that? It's not people that live in the city. It's usually people that live in suburban
okay.
and rural areas.
No, the biggest voice.
And not necessarily these people are not very friendly to us.
They have the biggest voice. The teachers' unions have the biggest voice.
I
and
disagree.
They're very organized.
I
and
disagree.
And they're supported by our tax dollars, and they're able to fight for their special interest.
Well, their special interest should be education. But we still, and I'm still saying, we still overlook the fact of who basically supports local education.
You say their special interest is education. Do we want a longer school day? Do we want a longer school year? They get paid throughout the year, even though they only work 8 months out of the year.
Don't say that. Teachers don't like to hear that.
I simply agree that
teachers don't like to hear that.
There's no reason why the schools should be closed 2 months in a year.
And then let me say this.
I totally
the suburbs, the city schools aren't able to have after school programs without the engineers or whatever charging an arm and a leg to do things in the programs. Why not make our schools run them 24 hours and have after school programs for adults that can help them with training and better prepare them for jobs of tomorrow? Why can't we do that? But the thing is, you got folks that just ain't with it.
And where's the money going to come for that?
Why not? Mm-hmm. Why not at least keep the schools open so people can do stuff, mm-hmm. have a place to meet? The place is gonna be heated and lit it up anyway.
Right.
So why not at least start there?
You got a problem.
But see, people keep talking about $1 billion budget.
Right.
$1 billion budget. How much of that is to pension? How much money goes to teachers?
About 80% of his salaries, maybe another 10% mm-hmm. is pension. Very little of it goes to programming
right.
and
that's
the
it.
Actual. Teaching of our kids, most of it, and that's because guess what? You get a union president that's as strong as Phil Roomore. He's fighting for his folks. He's not fighting for education.
And he's doing it very effectively.
Yes. Yeah. If I was a member, I would vote.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. So what you have is that you have parents who are concerned about their kids' education in the city, trying to find ways to get their kids into Amherst, Cheektowaga, trying to say that they, so Amherst to Cheektowaga, they have to hire staff to monitor to make sure that their people in their neighborhoods are not paying for these city kids, and they're kicking them out and they're driving them back to the city unless they can find a legal way to get there, to go to these schools. When you have a school system that that Roscoe is talking about failing, and you can measure it by the fact that none of the teachers in that school system will have their kids in that school system. Now that's
unless
a major
city
factor.
Unless
it's a couple of schools,
or
city honors,
or
performing arts,
or right.
yeah. So you got a handful of schools, three to five schools that they would, but other than that, they're not going to be in at any of the Buffalo public schools.
The fact of the matter is that 75% of the budget, 75% of the budget goes to teachers and pensions and people that work in the system. Very few of those dollars actually go to the children.
But I don't know how you can get around that.
But
Frank, that Kyle Palladino that Mary doesn't like, he's the one that raises the issue of why do we have kids from the suburbs going to City Honors? And then everybody wants to get quiet.
Good point.
You know, he's bringing
why do all the teachers' kids go to City Honors?
Well, I'm going to bring up another subject right here that we haven't touched on and I really want us to do, and this is part of criminal justice. And there were many Trayvon Martins in 2013. This is a question, will this change in 2014? Well, I say probably not. Is it time to repeal these states with stand your ground laws? We don't have it in New York State, but I think now there's up to 14 states that do have stand your ground laws. I want to find out for that. And as far as criminal justice goes, liberty, justice, for all, is that kind of outdated? And we have three people, basically, even four, who know something about the criminal justice system because in one way or another, they're kind of involved in it.
Well, I think this, as far as the empathy and the sympathy for Trayvon Martin, I think that probably exists across the board that people regret, particularly what they saw, what happened to the perpetrator, subsequently,
Mr. Zimmerman. His actions, and now, if they knew what they knew now, then he might not have been found not
exactly
guilty.
That he has a propensity to engage in that kind of conduct, and they didn't know that then, and they probably would not have known it at the trial level. It would not have been admissible. However,
but is there simply a problem with in our criminal justice system in the United States when it comes to the poor, the disadvantaged, and especially people of color?
Well, I mean,
and many of you are in city court, probably more than one time.
Well, Mary, it's back to money. It's back to who you can hire. If it's a defense counsel, are you always relying on you know a public?
Let me ask you, Terry, do you think his lawyer? Do you think the prosecution botched that case
on Trayvon?
Mm-hmm. Well, by going for that most severe penalty.
You know, when you're up against a law to stand your ground, you know what I mean? And as Mary is talking about, I think what they're coming to find out, Mary was saying, do you think it's just not so much not survive because of sympathy or empathy for Trayvon Martin, but what they're finding and what they, those who look at it, they know that this thing is coming back on them, you know, in domestic situations. I mean, anybody with a law like that that exists can say, you know, I shot him because I felt threatened by him. And, you know, take the racial element out of it entirely. I mean, this is a very dangerous thing to have where you don't have to say, as we do in New York State, well, you should have tried to get away. You should have tried to retreat.
But in the same state, you had the woman who was being beaten,
came back.
Now, she shouldn't have came back, but she came back and fired it in the air to ward him off and got 20 years. And it was only because
that
of this Trayvon
terrible,
case
terrible
that people brought
justice.
Attention
well,
to
and, I, and also, there's been several cases in Florida already where so-called gangbangers have used to stand your ground. Listen, I was approached. I shot him.
Yep.
You know, he was going to do danger harm to me, and I shot him.
That's a danger.
And they're finding that that's coming up more and more.
Oh, wow.
And who's to say, you know, because when they really wrote it, they thought it would just be for white people shooting black people, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, but now the legal is coming to bite them in the butt, like you were saying earlier. Mm-hmm.
Well, this is a problem here. Do you see any of that changing?
No.
I think that this gun control and that right wing element, the political side of that right now is so hot and so forceful. Anything that you try to do that looks like you're not on the side of being or on the side of against the possibility of crime or anything limiting the use of handguns, I think you're going to be shot down immediately.
I think this is what Roscoe was talking about earlier when he was talking about the Governor Cuomo's problems with this particular gun control law. And I think that the gun control lobby is very powerful. I think that people need to stand up and fight back against this.
But the thing is that it's not just
the
right.
Wild West.
It's not the right wing, though. There are a lot of Democrats that are hunters. All right. And the fact is that when you look at people who commit these crimes, you know, many of them, if a gun is involved, they have them illegally. If you look at the people that have guns legally, they're not the ones that are breaking the law. Okay, and so they look at this law as punitive against them
right.
because they're not breaking
but
the law.
But Roscoe, if we want a law that simply says, if you know that this, before you sell him the gun, at least make sure he's not totally insane. And for you to be against a law like that, I think you're being a little unreasonable.
But don't forget, yeah. Terry, there are groups in Buffalo, I know the Dory Miller Club have taken a stand mm-hmm. that they're against the SAFE Act. My husband and some of my family members, you know, they have gun license, and they are not supportive of the SAFE Act for those reasons. They think that it is taking their Second Amendment's right into consideration. I think that, as Roscoe said, SAFE Act will come back to haunt the governor in the election next year.
Well, what I'd like to find out in a few minutes, maybe we still have left in the program, is why does this nation need to be awash in handguns, in all kinds of weapons of all description? Why? This nation, of all the, I'm not talking about other smart, I'm talking all the industrialized nations in the world has the worst homicide record, has the worst criminal record than any. Why does this nation today, in 2014, need to be, its citizens have to be armed to the teeth?
It's American as apple pie.
Right, because they're paranoid white people who know that.
Look at the history. What is the one phrase you always hear? That shot heard around the world. All right, the fact is that how we broke away from England, guns, fighting for your freedom, guns, and it's just a part of
they the subjected the world through guns. I mean, you know, that's the only reason they ruled the world is because of guns.
They decimated the Native American right. population. The only reason that guns were unregulated basically was because white men and women, but mostly white men, needed that to control, as they thought, an unruly black population.
Right, and that's when the gun came into being, when black had access to guns.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
After, that's when those gun laws came into effect.
Well, folks, we're running down basically on a lot of our time here, and I want to first of all thank all my guests for being here. And I want to remind everybody that you can see this program. You can see this program on the web. Just go to www.themarydavisshow.com. And you can see this very program on your TV or on your internet or wherever you're looking at it. Again, just have to go to www.themarydavisshow.com. Again, that's www.themarydavisshow.com. And you can see this very show on your web. And again, before I go, I want to get one prediction from all of you. We started that way before. Why don't we start with Representative Betty Jean Wright. What are your predictions for 2014?
Well, my prediction 2014 is that Councilman Pridgen will be council president. And if Mr. Cromwell will choose Mr. Brown to be lieutenant governor, then Councilmember Pridgen, Council President Pridgen will be mayor of Buffalo.
What is your prediction, Roscoe?
That you might have a credible Republican candidate for county executive. And
I might have?
No.
We may have.
The Republicans may have mm-hmm. a serious contender for that seat. And I also think that the county executive polling cards will get a serious challenger from the Democratic Party.
What's your predictions, Terry?
Regardless of who's elected or who's not elected in 2014, I think we need to be concerned about 2016. I've been reading books on the coming crash for many years. However, mm-hmm. now this book by Tom Hartman, talking about all the pieces now in place for 2016, I think we have to brace ourselves.
What about you, Frank? What are your predictions for 2014?
I think the Democrats are going to take back the House in 2014, and I think Obama's going to get a full year of 2 years of
peace and quiet.
I'm going to be flying. Donkeys are flying.
We'll see.
Donkeys are flying.
You check my predictions in the last past years. I've come been right a lot.
Yeah, we'll see that.
Not all the time, but a lot.
Keep this on file.
Well, one prediction that I have as an African American woman, I would like to hope that there might be peace in the Erie County Legislature, and that at least and that two black women on that legislative body could get along. I think it's a disgrace.
Mary, I work with everybody, and I stand to see
I'm
that.
I'm not talking about you. You're okay. Sitting here. I'm talking about someone else, and that's going to be the last word for us.
Why come we ain't got no black men on the legislature?
Well, that's a point, too.
That's a point, too.
That's a point, too.
They didn't run.
But I would hope that there would be some kind of thing. I hate to find myself having to always go to war. I'm your host, Mary Davis. Show, of course, is the Mary Davis Show. Stay with this channel throughout your day. Thank you.